Again, I think we have to start finally our last lecture of today in the long row of discussive events. I am first of all very, very happy to welcome Peter Osborne. Thank you so much, Peter, for kindly accepting our invitation. And I know that it's not your first time in Kyiv, but nevertheless the first time within the biennial framework. So the lecture is titled Crisis as Forum, a Framework for Analysis, and I believe this also refers to the book that you are currently working on. The abstract of the lecture sounds pretty mysterious, but yeah, the main thing in that regard is that basically it's somehow the conjuncture or the overlapping of post-socialist condition with contemporaneity as such. So Peter Osborne is professor of modern European philosophy and director of the Center for Research in Modern European Philosophy at Kingston University in London. He has held visiting international chairs in the philosophy department at the University of Paris 8, the Royal Institute of Art, Stockholm, the Yale University School of Art. He has also contributed to a range of international journals like After All, Art Forum, New Left Review, October, and Texte zur Kunst and others, as well as catalogues for art institutions, including Manifesta, Tate Modern, Biennale of Sydney, and many, many others. And he was also co-curator of the Norwegian representation at the Venice Biennial in 2011. From 1983 to 2016, he was an editor of the British journal Radical Philosophy, and he is also the author of the following books: The Politics of Time, Modernity and Avant-Garde, Philosophy and Cultural Theory, Conceptual Art, Marx, Anywhere or Not at All, Philosophy of Contemporary Art, by the way, part of which was translated into Ukrainian as part of the edition called Moving Space, published by the Kyiv publisher house Medusa Books. And that's, I believe, the only translation into Ukrainian of your works. And the Post-Conceptual Condition. So his next book, which is forthcoming next year, is exactly titled Crisis as Forum. Thank you so much again.
Thank you, Basil and your colleagues in the Biennale Alliance for inviting me. This talk comes with a small health warning, which is that it's a theory talk. It's a framework for an analysis, my subtitle. It's meant to be a slight warning that it's a theory talk. It's slightly sadistic of the organizers to make it the last one in the day. But we shall see what we can do with this. I'm very pleased to be back here in Kiev. I'm just going to begin by saying something about this. I was actually last in Kiev 25 years ago. It occurred to me slightly belatedly that probably most people in the room I'd be speaking to would have been less than 5 years old 25 years ago. But I was here for 2 years running in 95 and 96 in a slightly strange context, which was the curatorial workshop that preceded the opening of the Soros Center for Contemporary Art in Kiev in 1995. Then I came back in 1996. There was quite a large Boris Mikhailov retrospective in 1996, which I'm told has been largely forgotten about. It was a very good show. I came back to give a talk at that show. As most of you will no doubt be aware, however young you were in 1995, the Soros Centers for Contemporary Art used contemporary art as Soros's personal oligarchic entree into the transformation of ex-socialist states in Eastern and Central Europe into capitalist societies. His idealized model of capitalist modernization aimed to use art, both symbolically and practically, to sponsor the revival and modernization of pre-Soviet national cultures across the whole region. in contradictory combination with neoliberal economic policies, in the hope of fostering the kinds of liberal electoral democracies which, following Karl Popper's theory of the open society, he took and still takes to be the political condition of so-called free markets. So I have one slide about this. There you go. This is the week before the opening of the SAR Center. That's the SAR Center there, getting belatedly installed. The source networks of centres place contemporary art at the forefront of this process, and I don't think that they were wrong in some quite deep way to do this, unfortunately, in what is retrospectively a striking anticipation of the subsequent institutional hegemony of the term contemporary art, which actually still wasn't used institutionally very much in the early 90s, which was, or at least some people thought, was the heyday of postmodernism. Contemporary art was the mechanism used to introduce Western models of cultural management, and it was thought to help form national liberal subjectivities. This is a very kind of contradictory notion, but it's at the core of this project, and it's the contradiction which is, if you like, at the core of the transformation, the sort of stalled transformations of ex-Soviet states into capitalist societies, liberal, national liberal subjectivities. This was, in a certain respect, both contradictory and naive. First, because the national stroke nationalist aspect of such subjectivities, and that ambiguity cannot be avoided, the national always, in some sense, morphing into the nationalist. These national subjectivities did not remain cultural, but were immediately political in a way that conflicted with the kind of naturalized ideal of liberal subject formation that Soros assumed, mistakenly in my view, lay dormant beneath the yoke of Soviet societies waiting to be awakened. That was essentially the Western view of Eastern Europe in the early 90s. But the national, of course, was by no means exhausted by its anti-Soviet function. That was its main function in the 90s. The national was to be anti-Soviet. Secondly, the idea that 70 years of state and social history in the Ukrainian crisis, 1922 to 1991, could be simply wiped away more or less overnight was deeply phantasmatic. It was inevitable that certain of the more problematic and historically deeper social and cultural forms that it had repressed would return in new forms under new conditions, in contradiction to both the aspiring subject formations of liberal democratic capitalism and the residual social content of the Soviet forms. That was already pretty clear in the mid-90s, it's even clearer now. And in a sense, it hardly needs stating. Although, in a sense, there's another sense in which, at a deep structural level, perhaps not so much has changed since 1995. We can talk about that. Okay. I'm going to just give you, I'll just show you a couple of pieces in the opening show. You're probably familiar with these. Alexandra Litilsky's view of the matter from 1995 in the opening show. Soros, one suspects, may not have fully anticipated the complex roles that the different churches in Eastern Europe were to play in this transformation. In a sense, he had a model of capitalist transformation that effectively didn't really take account of the role of the church, or rather the churches, the multiple and contradictory relation between churches in Eastern Europe. That was contrasted with something by an artist who now produces very different work, Ilya Chichkin, his works have changed quite dramatically since those days. Here he's using shutters from his apartment as light boxes, which is really a kind of oriented towards Western artistic appropriations of elements of the history of the Russian avant-garde. In some way, it's quite a, from a Western point of view, it's quite an orthodox work, but in the context of that sort of show, it was a kind of a sort of rare moment of deep historical clarity. I show you these just to give some art historical texture to that moment of contemporary art, which I'm going to use in inverted commas here. So that's a kind of, that's the dialectical image of the domestic, westward-looking artistic forms of that year in that show at Soros, those two things. The works in that opening show were not, of course, representative of the production of very many artists in Kiev at the time. If one went to artist studios, as we were taking around, especially artists in the Artist Union in 1995, many, if not most, of the male artists were at that time mainly using their newfound freedom to paint large and lascivious female nudes in a pornographic manner. I suspect in about 50 years' time, in the same way that round about 1995, Brezhnevian socialist realism suddenly became very fashionable, I fear the revenge of these terrible pornographic paintings, should they be being archived somewhere by people? Let's hope not. Nor was the duration of that show, which was several weeks, and which was attended by the American ambassador, of all people, in any way representative of the impoverished but intensely event-based local art scene in the weeks that I was here anyway, in which the merging of art events with club culture, or really the staging of art as a kind of supplementary aspect of club culture, which has become much more familiar across the art world internationally now, was very prominent. And in a way that people associate that with Berlin, but in a way it was pioneered in ex-Soviet states, Baltic states as well, as a result of their quite specific economic conditions. Namely, firstly, the sudden withdrawal of the state, secondly, the non-existence of the market, and back then, apart from Soros as the sole proxy for foreign states, no NGOs either. Now, of course, you have the Pinchuk Art Center, which is a kind of mimesis of garage in Moscow, making a cultural claim for your national capital within the international art market. I'm going to come back to Pinchuk a bit later. I mention all this not merely for biographical reasons, but also because I think that moment in the mid-1990s, in the early years, just 4 years into the independent Ukraine, remains one of the layers of historical time from which the present may still be usefully viewed, symptomatically. In this respect then, and slightly oddly, I come to you as a kind of time traveller from a very particular moment in your national past, 1 month in 1995. Okay, that's my intro. We'll now do theory. I'm not going to be so foolhardy as to attempt, as those misreading the question mark at the end of my abstract might have thought, as to give you an analysis of the situation, social consequences, or artistic effects of post-socialist capitalism in Ukraine. Okay, I don't know enough to do that. You know about that, not me. Rather, what I'm going to do is I'm going to offer some general conceptual and theoretical resources to introduce a way of thinking about it. Conceptual resources that produce a certain standpoint, or rather a standpoint regarding the relation between standpoints, that orientates thinking in a particular direction and provides a framework for the interpretation and analysis and self-reflection of local knowledges and experiences, right? So you have to kind of existentially fill in the content to my extremely abstract and formal talk, right? That's the way this works, if it works at all. Okay. My framework has four elements. Oops, oh, it's gone too far. I've lost the slide. I'm in the wrong order. Yeah, okay, I'm in the wrong order. These are my four elements. Contemporaneity is a form of historical time. So something about the concept, something theoretical about the concept of contemporaneity. Secondly, something a bit more specific. Contemporaneity is a temporality of crisis, or more specifically and more interestingly, a temporality of the crisis of crisis. This is my kind of definition of the current historical temporality. Thirdly and briefly, in some ways most obviously, post-socialist capitalism as a new global form, in other words, not as Eastern and Central European form, a global form. And finally and briefly, contemporary art as the possible space for the contested articulation of global economic and local cultural and political social forms, yeah? Like a site of contestation. Okay, the first two sections, which are the more theoretically heavy sections, are the longest, you'll be pleased to know. Okay, contemporaneity is not just the name for the temporal quality of the present. Some people treat it like that. As a living relation between different times, as if that quality had some distinctive positivity to it, some kind of presence, some people think, which gives it some kind of dehistoricizing eternality. There's been a kind of leakage of Jameson's concept of postmodernism as an eternal present into some people's views about the temporality of contemporaneity. I don't think contemporaneity as a temporal form is like that at all. But nor, on the other hand, does it name anything as punctual and interruptive as the now, which I think is a quite different temporality. Rather, as a critical concept, for me, contemporaneity names the disjunctive conjunctions between the different social and historical times that are placed into relations with one another through the practices of human dependency. So human social dependency is the concept which is at the core of this talk. Contemporaneity is a differential relational structure of temporalities which extends in any particular instance precisely as far spatially as the social relations of dependency upon which human life is based in that instance. Okay. Which means now in all instances it extends an extremely long way. That is to say, under the globalizing conditions of capitalist social relations in the present, the globalization of capital-based economic markets and their systems of communications technologies, it names a structure of temporality on a global scale. This is why it's now a historical form of temporality. And I'm going to talk about capital markets because there was at least, not less now, less since the financial crash of 2008, but certainly in a lot of discourses about Eastern Europe, a lot of liberal discourses about Eastern Europe, tended for many years to try to reduce the concept of capitalism to the concept of market. And so there's an absolute categorical divide between these categories. There are many kinds of markets, there are socialist markets. What's distinct about capitalism is the ownership of the means of production and the necessity that people sell their labour power to those owners in order to live. That's two special kinds of market, labour market, capital market, not markets in general. Okay. The concept of the contemporary is in this respect a critical means for grasping a new form of historical time. As this temporal structure becomes increasingly diffused and increasingly socially dominant, it is intensified and complicated, cutting across and transforming previously established social and historical relations. In this respect, the concept of the contemporary has been worked by history itself as a process into a historical concept. In the sense in which, according to the French philosopher of science, Georges Congien, according to his conception of what it means to work a concept, and this is now my most theoretical bit, if you survive this, you'll be fine. Here's the quote from Congien. I hope the translators are going to do this well. To work a concept is to one, vary its extension and comprehension. Two, to generalize it through the incorporation of exceptional traits. Three, to export it beyond its region of origin. And four, to take it as a model or, on the contrary, to seek a model for it. So overall, to work a concept, in short, is progressively to confer upon it through regulated transformations the function of a form. From a structuralist point of view, and this is a kind of proto-structuralist definition of working a concept, all serious intellectual operations are in some sense operations which work concepts, which transform them in relation to particular contexts and other theories. So to just talk through the concept of contemporaneity through these four movements, varying the extension and comprehension of the concept of contemporaneity, this occurs by interpreting within the terms of the philosophy of history, understood after the critique of narrative philosophies of history as the philosophy of historical time. So it means taking the concept out of the discourse of the history of design, out of the discourse of the art world, and putting it into the discourse of the philosophy of historical time. This takes contemporaneity from the socio-spatial temporal domain of relations between individuals, localized, culturally navigable spaces within the time span of conventionally structured human lives, that is to say, birth, childhood, adolescence, maturity, adulthood, middle age, old age, death. And that is, of course, if you're lucky, and the cycle is not interrupted, into the conceptual space of possible relations at a global level between socially and geographically disparate people. This is where this connects up to the question of trans-periphery. Socially and geographically disparate people whose lives are temporally coeval, that is to say, they share the same chronological present of possible encounter, but who are nonetheless subject to quite different, as well as some shared, forms of social temporality. The concept of contemporaneity therefore morphs from referring to a common or shared time of lives to become a kind of temporality that is differentially produced practically by the relations of dependency between lives governed by different social times, none of which are reducible to the temporal time of their encounter or interaction. Okay, and this is not just the kind of palimpsestic layering of time. Some people talk about layering of time. Caselli talks about layering of time. He also talks about the sedimentation of time. I don't mean it in that kind of geological sense, which is much too fixed. The relation between these times is not one of sedimentation or palimpsestic interpretation. Rather, it's an ongoing dynamic and contradictory articulation in which all of these times are, if you like, alive in the present. There are attempts to, if you like, explain away reactionary political movements by saying that, if you like, they belong to old times, that they're stuck in old times. But it's the function of reactionary political movements to make old times new. If you forget that they're doing that, then you're not engaging with them at all. You're wishfully thinking that they belong to the past. Meanwhile, they're doing you in the present. Okay, two. generalize the concept through the incorporation of exceptional traits. This is an effect of the effect of the extended comprehension of contemporaneity as a global form, or more particularly as a marker of experiences, of contradictory experiences, of processes of synchronization and desynchronization. There's a sense in which systematically these are the main concepts, synchronization and desynchronization. From everyday life upwards to the experience of historical movement itself. Third, exporting it beyond its region of origin. This is taking it from place-based forms of social interaction to generational cultural histories into the non-place-based, non-locational space of flows and non-places, which, if you like, spatially determine the relations between people communicating through digital technologies. Fourth, taking as a model. Taking contemporaneity as a model for the effect within the present of a contradictory temporal relations of global capitalism, and at the same time seeking a model for it in the specific relations between different social, economic and political dependencies, relations created by these digitally based global capital markets and social communicational forms. There's a tendency to think of the immediacy of digital internet-based relations in terms of social media. Their primary function, of course, is to render more instantaneous financial markets, is to reduce the time of financial transactions to just a few nanoseconds. And a lot of the competition between traders these days is all to do with building their own fiber optic networks that will be 10 nanoseconds faster than the one down the road on Wall Street. That's how you make your money if you're a finance capitalist in New York. Okay. So there are those new social relations, and they're also tied up with them, the new reactive geopolitical formations at various levels, which attempt to respond to these economic relations. So there's the IMF, there's the International Monetary Fund, there's the World Bank, all the way down to institutions like the Soros Centers in the 90s, the Pinchuk, and even this biennial itself, insofar as these are all political formations that attempt to constitute different kinds of social subject relative to their standpoint within this overall process. So I take that the constitution of a kind of self-consciousness of trans-peripheral relations, if you like. I take that to be like the goal of this biennale, in a way. People start to think those relations differently. The collapse of the Soviet Union transformed some constitutive internal relations into external relations. Ukraine's relation to Russia, for example, is now an external relation, whereas it was previously an internal relation. Intensifying their antagonistic qualities while making a whole series of other external relations possible, but also problematic. So formal independence and sovereignty, so 1991, if you like, in Ukraine, brought with it a whole new series of relations of dependency. Relations of dependency on foreign capital, relations of dependency on the geopolitical imaginary of NATO, in which it suddenly became a buffer state, which it never was before, and also, of course, of the European Union. As well as allowing for the production of new regional imaginaries, which are also in part restorations or revivals of older regional imaginaries. And I think the conversation earlier about the terms Eastern and Western, Eastern Europe and Central Europe was quite interesting, because that's a competition between two specific pasts. It's basically a competition between the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Soviet Union. But while, if you like, the choice of geopolitical imaginaries is whether to self-describe in relation to the Austro-Hungarian Empire or the Soviet Union. You're still, if you like, you haven't quite caught up with your former sovereign independence. On the other hand, new generational mobilities, and mobility is central to this, and that's why COVID is having such, will I think have such long-term political consequences, because mobility is so, been so restricted, are redrawing cultural maps according to different generational cultural political logics. Meanwhile, however, and it's my brief return to Pinchuk, the corporatism of institutions like Pinchuk reproduce the set formats of global artistic identity formation required for Western artistic careers in increasingly automated and routinized forms. The curatorial narratives that drive those careers, which essentially derive from the earlier critical biennales of the first years of the 21st century, have here become increasingly formulaic and artistically empty, demanding of young artists a certain fixed relation between biography and artistic identity, which is endlessly repeated curatorially according to the same format, irrespective of the work which it is describing. This is a kind of curatorial death of young art. This quiet violence of complicity is, however, increasingly a condition of entry into the formal art system. The main mediating institution here is actually the corporatization of the art school, particularly, unfortunately, in the UK, is at the forefront of kind of reducing art schools to kind of American management structures that belong to American corporations in the 1950s, before people realized they didn't work even then. The analytical, existential, and political questions that are raised by these concerns are how to understand and how to live inside this new contradictory structure of temporal relations as a social subject, the sociality of which is both quite elastic and indeterminate, yet nonetheless clearly bounded by new forms of dependency. So I think it's a kind of fundamental existential question that is posed by the concept of contemporaneity for us all. This movement of regulated transformations within a dialectical process of construction and dismantling demonstrates the motile function of contemporaneity in its historical extension. It's this motility that connects it, and moving on to my second point here, there's the list, to the concept of crisis. The problem posed by global contemporaneity for the concept of crisis is twofold. On the one hand, in the course of the last 50 years, the spatial disjunctions between national political organizations and transnational or global capital have structurally disarticulated the subjective and the objective aspects of crisis. You can see this in relation to its historical semantics. That is to say, they have structurally disarticulated the relationship between crisis as a moment of decision, which is the etymological origin of a crisis, and crisis as a moment of transition. Right? And these two aspects of what used to be tied together in the classical concept of crisis, decisions that affected transitions, that's what politics was, making decisions that affected transitions, not aestheticizing your banners and taking them straight from the floor into Reina Sofia without even using them to demonstrate, right? Very, very bad. On the other hand, the globalization of capital relations through financial markets appears to have exacerbated the objective structural tendencies towards economic crisis into something like a permanent condition, at least in the West, insofar as it still exists as such, with stagnant wages and lack of productive investment opportunities for capital, forcing capital increasingly into speculative financial routes, which are inherently unstable, due to their inherently fictitious character. That's the Marxist term for that kind of investment. It's here that the temporality of global contemporaneity appears as itself a temporality of crisis. It's a permanent putting into crisis of the forms of social reproduction of capital, and therefore of social reproduction more generally. Indeed, in its apparently now unexceptional character, it appears as a crisis in the concept of crisis itself, since classically, a crisis requires of necessity a resolution in one of two forms. Transition to a new form of social reproduction of the existing system, the patient lives, or the collapse of the existing social form, the patient dies. These are the two classic forms of resolution of a crisis. As Marx insisted in his argument against Adam Smith in the theories of surplus value, capitalist crises are cyclical or periodic. This is the quotation from Marx. Permanent crises do not exist. Okay. Permanent crises do not exist. And yet we appear to have permanent crises, which makes us think maybe we don't have a crisis. Maybe we have something else. Something which is worse than crisis. The permanent transition of the time consciousness of modernity, that is to say the permanence of the new, for example the old, time consciousness of the modern, is not a temporality of crisis, as some people, like Jameson, suggest. It's a temporality of repetition. A temporality of repetition that, because of its structure of repetition, represses duration. Itself pointing, if you like, anticipating the concept, the crisis and the concept of crisis. At the highest level of abstraction, the problem arises from the difference between the two main temporalities at play within global capitalism here. It's to say the modern and the contemporary. The still insistent temporality of the modern as the new, what Adorno called the aesthetic seal of expanded reproduction, that is to say the temporality of the accumulation of capital, and secondly, the temporality of contemporaneity, which is spatially based disjunctive conjunctions which modify the economic temporality of the modern and render it more internally, temporally, and spatially more complicated. The relation between these two temporalities of the modern and the contemporary presents itself as the problem of synchronization. The synchronization of spatially distributed economic processes nationally, regionally, globally, but also, crucially, the synchronization of economic processes with political processes of economic regulation and enforcement, along with other social practices, including the practices of everyday life, which depend upon these economic processes, and into which systemic relations are condensed, and through which they are experienced, expressed, and suffered, increasingly as debt, which is the, if you like, the individual consequence of the inability of finance capital to avoid crisis. In this respect, the common argument that globalization is a process of social homogenization. Anti-globalization activists, particularly of the 90s, used to argue that globalization was like a homogenizing process, is badly misplaced. Rather, the opposite appears to be true. Globalization involves an intensification of differential relations within an always tenuous process of unification through synchronization. Within this process, homogenization operates at three levels, but these levels are very rarely synchronized, so the process as a whole is not homogeneous. The levels are the various abstract determinations of the value form, commodity, money, capital, the transnationalization of regulatory frameworks, particularly, for example, the European Court of Justice as a kind of contractual court. And of course, there's a struggle going on between the states of ex-Eastern Europe and the European Court of Justice. I mean, this is where the struggle about the relation between ex-Soviet states and the European Union is focused. And thirdly, the communicational meta medium of the internet and other satellite-based communication systems. Unification is not necessarily homogenization. It's more likely to be the product of a temporary relational articulation of heterogeneous elements, producing a fragile reproducibility. What's being exposed in the moment around the world is the fragility of the systems of social reproduction upon which capital depends for its own expanded reproduction. That's to say, because it transmits its crisis from its own reproduction to social reproduction in general. So crises are always crises of social reproduction. Antipathy to homogenization generally conceives itself as antipathy to capital and its effects, displaced onto its geopolitical dynamic. But that is not actually a homogenizing process. It's the new differentials that are causing havoc and are essentially making historically redundant the basic 19th century political forms of European states, including the concept of sovereignty. Okay, so here's my strong geopolitical point. In this respect, the ex-Soviet independent states of Central and Northeastern Europe became sovereign at the very moment of the historical redundancy of the concept of sovereignty. They gave you a prize, but the box was empty. Indeed, ironically, their becoming sovereign, that is to say leaving the Soviet Union, helped produce the conditions for the redundancy of the form of sovereignty which they thereby acquired, since it acted as a basic stimulus to the denationalization of foreign capital. In its most extended sense, then, contemporaneity is the overarching temporal envelope of what looks like a global crisis, but it's perhaps something more profound, a more profound change in the structure of social relations themselves. All structural crises of capitalism are root crises of the realization of value, grounded in disjunctions between moments in the circulation of reproduction of money, capital, one way or another. These disjunctions each have specific temporal expressions or mode of existence, the totality of which constitute any particular crisis. Empirically, the socio-spatial presupposition that rendered the aspiration to general historical mediation credible if tenable, if tenuous for 100 years from the 1860s to the end of the 1960s, namely national capitals, national labour, nation states, and socialist internationalism, that's the configuration of those 100 years. They no longer hold as determining factors of economic relations. Rather, economic crises are increasingly the product of markets and finance capital, which structure global contemporaneity. There is thus now simultaneously both an apparent convergence between the temporal structure of crisis and contemporaneity, and an ever greater disjunction between economic and political temporalities. Or to put it another way, there is, if you like, an ever greater disjuncture between events and acts. It's the aspiration of politics, if you like, to act in such a way as to produce an event. Right? Increasingly, historical events and acts are operating at different levels. Right? This is, if you like, the political problem of the fundamental impotence of the Wall Street movement. On the one hand, this gap between events and acts reinforces the tendency to naturalize economic crises. On the other hand, though, because of the perceived source of the crisis in specific forms of financial practice, there is also a contradictory repoliticization of the perception of economic crisis as the result of financial markets, but only in a negative and reactive way. Hence we have what I take to be the current global political situation of the left, anti-capitalism without a post-capitalist imaginary. This is the impasse. anti-capitalism without a post-capitalist imaginary. And that's why there's so much aesthetics on demos. Here, the political effects of the Badiouian dictum that temporalization is subjectivation. Re-temporization is re-subjectivation. At all levels of subject formation is clear to see. From the self-differentiating subject function of the value form itself, all the way down to its condensed expression in the lives of individual human beings, attempting to organize the effects of these processes to which they are subjected into practically manageable life narratives and conditions of action. So this is the existential problem I think we all face, which is disavowed by being presented as resolved in advance by all that formulaic curation of biographies within the current art system. The art world wants artists to have fixed social identities. And that's why we can't produce any interesting art at the moment. Because interesting art doesn't come from fixed social identities. Interesting art comes from wildly indeterminate social identities, contradictory social identities. In this respect, we can say, as a retemporization of crisis, global contemporaneity involves newly fractured differential subjectivations of history, which are currently lived more in the mode of subjection, that is to say, the mode of domination, being dominated, than any possible resubjectivation in the sense of the production of subjects, which are the agent of free acts. Individual and social processes of subjectivation, desubjectivation, and resubjectivation are restructured by this globally disjunctive temporality. The concept of history itself thus increasingly appears, indeed, as it was described in the early 1970s by the Italian architectural historian and theorist Manfredo Tafuri, as that of a temporary inactuality. This is what Tafuri said. He said, we were suffering the temporary inactuality of history. That temporary inactuality has become more intense. The temporary inactuality of history transforms history from an objective process, as to say, the unity of the process, into a project. Indeed, we can conclude, following, Tafuri's line into the concept of contemporaneity, that history as a project, and this is the worst theoretical mouthful I'm going to offer you, history as a project is the negativity of the unity of global crisis. That is, it's the negativity of the unity of the disjunctions constitutive of global contemporaneity. That is a mouthful, but if you can think it through, you need to think it through in order to ask yourself the question, what is the relationship between the political act and historical change? One thing that's occurring at the moment is the total collapse of the Enlightenment concept of politics. The Enlightenment concept of politics conceived politics as a form of act that had a historical effect. Current forms of global contemporaneity disjoin acts from events in a way that destroys the classical concept of politics. So it lives on in sort of intensely sporadic, jerking remnants like the limbs of a decapitated chicken. Okay, I'm coming to a close. My third point. Post-socialist capitalism is a new global form. Now my point is quite brief. Post-socialist capitalism, I want to argue, should not primarily be understood as the name for any kind of national or regional variety of capitalism associated with ex-Soviet states. Rather, it is the name But the global situation of capitalism after the collapse of the Soviet Union, right? It's the name for what happened to the whole after the change in one of its parts. There's an interesting comparison here with the phrase New World. When Columbus finally revealed the Americas to Europeans in 1492, people started talking about the New World. But when people talked about the New World in 1492, the New World didn't mean what it meant to 19th century Europeans. It didn't mean America, right? To Tocqueville's America was the New World. The New World was not the world that was the continent that was discovered by Columbus. The phrase New World at the end of the 15th century meant because Europeans have discovered this other continent, right? And that, all of its possibilities that will arise once it's genocided the current inhabitants. The world as a whole has changed. The world is new, right? Post-socialist capitalism is the name for a capitalism without any kind of effective internal social democratic opposition. Because the internal social democratic oppositions of European capitalist states depended upon the international rivalry with communism for their effect on those states. Fear of communism, okay, produced the concession of social democracy. Take away fear of communism and capitalism doesn't have to be social democratic anymore. Okay? And I'm afraid that's where we are. This is what some people call pure or even absolute capitalism. Rancière calls it absolute capitalism. Balibar, surprisingly, my colleague, has also started using the term. I think perhaps that's just, that's not quite right. Because to say absolute capitalism would be fatally, perhaps, to forget about China, which it's always a mistake to do, the last and the most powerful bastion of the economic sovereignty of national capital. When I visited the Academy of Social Sciences in Beijing in 1999 for a conference on geopolitics, the people working there, having drinks afterwards, said, do you know the game that the strategists, you know, are playing? No, I don't know what game this is. They have a book in the sense of a bet, and you can change your bet each year, but you have to put more money in, right? And the bet is, what is the first year in which China can beat America in a nuclear war? Okay. That was the strategist game. Some of them were over-optimistic. They said 2024 is the most optimistic. We hope they're wrong. Some of them thought it was longer, but it was the game in 1999. And it's still the game for some, but not so much of a game for others. Okay. How am I doing? I think maybe I should stop.
Wrap it up.
Yep. I have 3 pages about art at the end, which seems sad beside these geopolitical claims. Would you like 3 sad pages about art? I think we should, yeah?
Yeah, 10 minutes.
Yeah, that's fine. Contemporary art. See how small it feels? See how irrelevant it suddenly is? Contemporary art is a possible site for the contested articulation and reimagining of the relations between these global economic and local cultural and political social forms. Because art, in its modern bourgeois sense as autonomous art, is a mode of condensation and presentation of historical relations. One could say this is the lesson, if you like, the politicizing lesson of the critical biennales of the early 2000s, the larger ones. Before the format became overwhelmed and negated by the corporate interests and imperatives that were always one condition of its possibility, the Biennale as a kind of megaphone kind of died as a critical space about 10 years ago. The Biennale as a micro format, I'm pleased to say, here is alive and well. That's nice. If the mediation of form and content in art demands that we recognize artistic form as sedimented content, then the sedimented content of social form will always be internal to artistic form. From the constitutive illusion of modern art's autonomy, which models the constitutive illusion of liberal individuality, all the way through to the social and historical processes that are condensed into the artistic materials and technologies, materialities and conventions of making and unmaking, that present themselves to artists as part of their artistic present, as the definition of their, the artistic definition of their present at any particular time. In this respect, the expansion to infinity of possible artistic materials, which I take to be the defining characteristic of contemporary art, which turns every selection of artistic materials into an act of freedom. This is the fundamental core relationship between contemporary art and neoliberalism. In other words, if there are no historical constraints on your use of artistic materials, then your choice of artistic materials is wholly free. And in being wholly free, it figures that act as a kind of mad realization of the philosophical ideal of liberal individuality. Finally, a free act. This mimics the self-positing structure. Of course, it's not only mimicking the self-positing structure of liberal individuality, but it also mimics the self-positing structure of infinite productivity of the accumulation of capital. So there's two aspects of capitalist societies that are condensed into the notion of contemporary art. The freedom of the individual in their choice of artistic means and their infinite productivity. Obviously, a concept from the 18th century German Romanticism, fulfilled by capital as accumulation. The subject-like quality of the autonomous artwork as a self-determining form thus mimics both the fantasy of the self-possessing bourgeois individual and the actuality of the automatic subject of capital. And it does so not directly or immediately, but in each case via the alienated form of its own mediated objectivity, mimicking the alienated universality of the objective structures of social form, both of value and culture. So in other words, not just commodity, money, capital, state, the classical forms, but also gender, race, sexuality. Okay? They appear within the curatorial discourses of globalizing mainstream contemporary art, if you like, as alienated objectivities, fixed social forms in the same way. Indeed, insofar as sociality appears as form, it has only an alienated objectivity. So the basic issue here is less the sociological one with which people were for many years, maybe 100 years, obsessed. That is to say, the internality of autonomous art and the structures of capitalist societies by its own commodity form, that is to say, the contradictoriness of the art commodity, still less any relationship, artistic relationship of representation to reality at a thematic level, if you like, the problem of socialist realism. It's far more about the internality of the structures and processes of capitalist societies to autonomous art, qua autonomous art. Okay? Art is capitalist, not by avoiding the commodity form. Art is capitalist qua its separation from capital, qua its illusion of autonomy. This in a way reflects the deepest existential political problem we all face. Sorry, getting a bit depressed here. That problem is the imminence of capital relations to the basic structures of our own subjectivities. In so insofar as we spend most of our lives engaging in exchange relations, you know, we cannot posit capitalism as an object separate from us, about which we worry. We have to posit it as something which is internal to the structure of our subjectivity, qua, and not internal to our subjectivity as opposed to our freedom, internal to subjectivity as a specific form of our freedom. That's the scary bit. It's within this structural homology that crisis appears as form. In that crisis of form itself, which constitutes contemporary art. Contemporary art is a kind of ongoing crisis of form because it has no historical consistency. Contemporary art's a particular historical instantiation of the contradictory social form of art's autonomy, pushed to the point of a seemingly irresolvable antagonism or antinomy. Capitalist crisis is always a crisis in the consistency or coherence of the social itself. Contemporary art, in the critical sense of that term, is the art of such a situation.
Any questions to start? Because I don't even know from which angle to approach this.
People will think I'm employed by the guy behind the bar to increase trade.
Okay, so then.
Yes.
Okay. The question will be, I believe it must be the Russian or Ukrainian, then you will have a session. Sorry.
Good evening.
Does it work?
Not here. Can you hear anything?
Which channel?
Sorry.
Смотрите, да, современная история осмысливается как история отдельных государств. В то время как ключевые экономическая роль принадлежит корпорациям. Ну, например, ВВП какого-нибудь Гугла выше, чем ВВП Украины. Вот. Почему у нас до сих пор есть... Мы осмысливаем историю как историю государств, а не историю корпораций, собственно говоря, которые влияют больше на ситуацию современную. Вот. И, возможно, не только корпорации, а другие некие сетевые социальные структуры, которые не зависят от государств. Вот. В чем вообще роль государств сейчас? Она должна быть ниже, чем концепция, она есть в концепции глобализации.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a good point. I wouldn't say contemporary history is the history of individual states. I would say modern history was the history of individual states. Yeah? I would say telling it as the history of corporations is a kind of transitional way of telling it. According to my model, contemporary history is the history of the relation between different forms of capital. And the relations between different forms of capital overdetermine the existence or non-existence of particular corporations, okay, which can come into existence, become more powerful than individual states, but can also go out of existence quite quickly. The role of states currently is, if you like, to sustain the social reproduction of historically received national, inverted commas, by which I mean kind of phantasmatically projected in national communities, but increasingly states can only function economically. They can only give economic meaning to their sovereignty through self-harm. Right? Because the denationalization of capital means that effectively state elites, for reasons of their domestic economic management, now identify with the needs of international capital. Right? So they've given up, so that the economic needs of their population is conceived to be mediated by the needs of international capital in such a way that, if you like, they won't accept the existence of one contradicting the other. Right? They see populations that threaten the reproduction of international capital as a threat to the state. Nowhere is this clearer than in the comic self-harm of Brexit from the land from which I prevail. This is a political elite with so deeply invested a phantasmatic identification with the non-existent imperial past, right? They will destroy the whole economy in order to have national sovereignty from the EU, right? Which they don't have anyway. Because how are they going to use their newfound freedom? They're going to enter into 27 treaties, the content of which is identical to the one treaty they used to have with 27 people. So this is political pathology of quite an intense kind. But it tells us something about the character of these contradictions.
But just really short, быстро.
Можем ли мы говорить о реальном соперничестве между, допустим, Западом и Востоком, учитывая взаимозависимость там, Китая, например, и США? То есть, с одной стороны, в медиа их отношения характеризуются как противостояние или война, или там порог войны, но в то же время они взаимозависимы. Да, в то же время, например, дихотомия Россия и Запад, может ли она определяться как истинная, если мы учтем, что, например, 1/5 акций корпорации «Газпром» принадлежит British Petroleum, вот, и западным компаниям. То есть крупнейшая российская газовая корпорация имеет 20% западных компаний своей капитализации. О каком противостоянии мы можем говорить здесь?
It's a long time ago since Marx said monopoly is a form of competition. Right? It's a form of competition at a higher level. You're not competing within a single market, you're competing for profit between the general profitability of different markets. Right? The whole of the post-war so-called consensus, both in the weird sense in which the Cold War was in some sense a consensus, was a kind of weird agreement, structured as an imaginary war. The basic principle of the European Union was the only way to avoid war is to make people so economically interdependent that they really hurt themselves if they go to war, because their economic interests are always at stake. The problem with that theory is that this is where psychoanalysis becomes relevant, it underestimates the human investment in self-harm. This is why it's dangerous. So for example, if we take the China-America, the issue there, people talk about geopolitics, China has a massive surplus, which it holds in dollars. So America is massively indebted to China, right? But on the other hand, you know, it's pretty much like the Cold War. It's pretty much, you know, the threat of mutual destruction. Because either could do something to the dollar, which would destroy them both. Yeah. And the optimists think this will keep us all alive.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter, for this rich and really intense expose of the concept of contemporaneity. I guess the shorter version of a question I might formulate would be about the relationship between contemporaneity and actuality. But I have a longer one that concerns this notion of belated subjectivity that you mentioned in regard of Ukrainian and other post-Soviet countries gaining.
I don't think I said belated.
I'll reformulate this subjectivity that we sort of acquired after the subjectivity of space as such had been another one. So the whole ideology connected with the Soros Center and the Open Society and Hannah Arendt and this circle of authors kind of implies that Ukraine had been outside of history for the period of Soviet time.
I don't believe that at all.
Yeah, but we have this logic of catching up and the logic of being late and having to wait a little bit longer before.
This is the historicist logic of progressivism, which is the logic of modern time consciousness. Right? The thing about the contemporaneity is it's a structure of time which, if you like, renders all times radically coeval. It puts them into the same space of possible encounter. So belatedness doesn't make any sense, right? Because there is no, because history is no longer a narrative of progress. I don't believe, you know, that history progresses in that sense. History changes, it doesn't necessarily progress. And some people perceive that change to be an improvement at some times, and at other times not. I mean, to take your first point, what's the relation between contemporaneity and actuality? My whole point is contemporaneity is our current historical actuality, which is covered over by all these remnants of 19th century discourses about nations and states, international relations and free individuals. That's my point. So nothing belated is happening, but what is happening is that more and more people are entering into more and more exchange relations. And more aspects of social life are and will become subject to those exchange relations. And the more that happens, the more subjectivity is structured into the standpoint of the imaginary subject of contract law. Everything is an imaginary contract. Right? Sexual relations are imaginary contracts. She's laughing because I'm so optimistic.
I just want to ask Yeah, what you you just described, what you outlined as a contemporaneity, also this lack of effectiveness of political action.
Relative to the criterion of historical events.
Yeah,
relative to the criterion of historical events.
Yes.
Maybe we need to give up thinking that our acts can be historical events.
But do you think that this, what you describe, is like only related to European history? I mean, consequence of like Europe being cut out from history because basically like lost a war, like a world war, and was not allowed to make history anymore. But you know, if you go like
because I think at a certain point, retrospectively, it becomes clear that at a certain point in the 19th century, history became the history of capitalism. And at a certain point in the late 20th century, the history of capitalism increasingly became the history of the world.
But what if, just like a really small plot, but but if I, you know, if you look like at US or like China or like, I don't know, what is happening like in Taiwan or like also Japan.
China is a capitalist.
Yeah, it's
economy.
Capitalist, but it's still
making
politics in the sense that it's like creating a historic event. So, and also, to the point where, you know, it's like, it's also like...
It's the last historical actor, the Chinese state.
But US also, no. Japan, India, no?
Okay.
I don't want
to. You're reading the question itself, yeah.
Hi. Following the previous question, what do you think, is there a place for revolutionary change in contemporary world, or is it also a modern concept which is now, like, doesn't have place in it?
Yeah, I don't think the concept of revolution is helpful. This annoys a lot of my friends and colleagues. But it belongs to a discourse and an imaginary which no longer has a grip on these historically actual structures. I mean, it's very easy to talk about revolution and, you know, there haven't been any revolutions for a while now. You could say that what happened in Egypt was a failed, and for some people, belated bourgeois revolution, right? But it turned out to be a revolt, right? I think the word revolution trivializes the seriousness of the politics of social change. The question that is at stake in the concept of revolution, but is covered over by the word, is in what ways is it still possible to make fundamental social change? Right? That's not change at the level of the event, it's change at the level of the system of social reproduction. Right? Fundamental political acts are acts which change the relations which constitute a society. That's the issue. People used to call that revolution, okay? But even if we go back to the 19th century, I mean, you know, Marx didn't think capitalism was going to end with a political revolution, okay? I mean, if you take Marx's distinction between, if you take the temporality of the difference between political and social revolutions, okay? Revolutions that change state power have the temporality of years. Yeah, maybe a short temporality of decades. Temporality, events which put in processes that change modes of production, take 200-300 years. Okay. What's the temporality of the transition from feudalism to capitalism in Europe? If you take industrial capitalism to be the kind of moment in which it becomes, if you like, simply self-reproducing, it's 300 years minimum, right? Why do people think they're going to change capitalism next week? I know. They need to teach their children to teach their children's children, right? How to engage in long-term processes of political change. That's why political action become aestheticized. Because there's no affectivity, so they're pure appearance. And aesthetics is the discourse of modes of appearance. This is a real problem for non-religious consciousness. No, I'm serious. It's a real problem for non-religious consciousness because for centuries, societies were able to think about the long term because in a kind of imaginary way, they thought they would still be watching, right? They were able to do things for their children's children's children. They could plan it and think about it in 100 years' time because they had a religious consciousness that changed their relation to death, right? It's very hard to be a materialist about death and plan long-term social change. It's really serious.
Awesome. Hi. I have another question for you. Actually, maybe a... not a question, but a request to kind of take another perspective on what you're practically saying. Well, let's start with the framework for analysis and skip from that again back to the practical. And now it's great that you've touched on the fact that it takes a lot of time to change and that our, you know, contemporary culture will be the past until we see the change actually happen. And a few cultures, maybe the Japanese, the ones, they have some implemented foresight, I would say, or maybe a planning for like 200 or 300 years, theoretically. Whether it works practically, I'm not so certain. Yet, I mean, there are attempts to do so. So, how do we transform a concept from your analytical and purely philosophical viewpoints into implementing something for real and on a long term? For example, to bring it back to Ukrainian realities with our most recent Maidan and the revolution here. Myself personally, I found that I have accomplished my goals while I got here. I wanted to change the vector of this country to be more directed to the Western values, perhaps to a lesser corruption-enabled state, etc. So I feel I got what I paid for, pretty much, right? So, what is your perspective?
You're the lucky one.
Yes, I am. I truly am the lucky one. Thanks. And what is your perspective on turning, you know, analysis and practice?
I don't believe in Western values. what we call Western values are essentially the ideological representation of forms of subjectivity required to turn market societies into capitalist societies. Right? If you approach those values from the point of view of, well, what happens to the world when those values are realized, you might not want to hold them quite so tight. This is the problem of the internality of these processes to us. I mean, in terms of politics, obviously, groups of people act in ways that change things in societies. The question is how you conceive, what level you're conceiving this at, right? Are you conceiving this in some world historical way and saying revolution, right? Are you, you know, do you know what you're doing, what you're getting, when you think you're getting what you're calling freedom, which is the illusory sovereignty of a state that doesn't care too much about you, right? You know, it's about working out what is, if you like, where you can be practically effective without being too deluded, right? That's the question. What's the range? What types of group and what types of network, right? What forms of effective action are actually appropriate, you know, are possible, you know, for those groups? Yeah? And the point at which politics, if you like, becomes stagecraft again, people used to criticize Parliament because it was just like a stage in the real world. It wasn't in Parliament, it was on the street, right? But the street is now another performance, right? We've got Parliament, which thought was a performance. Now the performance is on the street, right? You've got to find the moment of possible effectivity. I mean, I'm not sure if she's still here. I apologize for these remarks about the previous paper because I'm kind of using them in a way.
She wants to discuss anything.
Yeah. You know, but you know, the point at which I began to worry about the logic of your argument was the point at which you made the connection to the counterculture and the 60s counterculture. Right? Because if you look at the historiography of European North American countercultures of the 1960s and 70s. You ask, if you like, what was the ultimate effect of those countercultures? And I'm not saying it was bad, but it wasn't what they thought it was. It was essentially to remove moral constraints on consumption. Right? It was essentially to produce markets for desires which religious consciousness had tried to get people to cover over. It produced markets in pleasure. Okay? No. Markets in pleasure are better to have a market in pleasure than no pleasure, right? But so it's not a bad thing, but it's not anti-capitalist. It's the transformation that gave post-war capitalism its distinctive form as a, if you like, as a culture industry.
Of course, that's one of the hegemonic readings of the counterculture of the 1960s. Actually, I think it's a very interesting debate. Mark Fisher, his last project was this acid communism and this idea, which I partly agree, partly disagree, of this the counterculture being a kind of a double project, one of which was appropriated and one of which was not appropriated. In this part, I think I agree with him. I don't agree with him as much as about the, you know, emancipatory possibilities of certain parts of the psychedelic culture. But regarding pleasure and pleasure as a principle for politics, I think we don't have to have this dichotomy. Also, I have a problem with this idea that aestheticizing or aesthetics is something contrary to long-term social change. Images will always be a visualization of political principles, and I don't think they are contradictory to it at all. And actually, I think that it's just a question of not placing one of two options, because these celebratory moments and these creation of images are, of course, not the social change in itself, but there are various studies, for example, Stephen Duncan, they have this Center for Creative Activism and conduct all these, you know, quantitative studies in which they look at lots of cases. And the artistic dimension is actually good for long-term fights. It's just that it's not the only thing. There has to be the other part, it's like kind of the point of the iceberg, to give a metaphor that's a bit wasted down. And this principle of pleasure, no fight will be sustainable in the long term if it doesn't do that part. And the counterculture of the 60s, in general, I just want to also say, like, I'm not saying this is what you have to do for social change, and just like, I was just presenting a genealogy of a certain aesthetic vocabulary and an aesthetic language that has been developed, and which of course has the 60s as a point of origin, because in the 60s it's when the you get a media culture that is strong enough in order to pose it that social change has to have a dimension in that arena. But of course I'm not saying this is the only way, in the sense that it has to be only a part of it, and I think any serious organizer in these movements agrees that it's only a part.
I mean, I'm not against social aesthetics, but I am against, so I'm kind of old school in this respect, I am against the aestheticization of politics in either direction, because in a sense it's the same thing.
You know, this idea that the aestheticization of politics leads to fascism, but I completely disagree. I think
he was thinking of the, we won't go into that.
If you read Nazism as a Gesamtkunstwerk and all of these readings, I just think that anything human has an aesthetic dimension. So I don't think
it's a common way of thinking you're doing politics when you're not, or thinking you're doing a kind of politics that you're not.
I think it's exactly the same as a verbal language. One can speak about politics and think that you're doing politics without actually doing it, or one can create an image and think that they are doing politics without actually doing it. Images or words are just languages, so that's just a part of any movement or any action, and they can come alone or they can be complemented by real action, and then I have to put comments about real.
But then how do you feel about the balance being made, never shown, and going straight into Reina Sofia?
Those banners were not, that's not the exact process. They were part of the, there were so many banners that there was an excess.
You explain, that is what happened.
There's 10 years in between, there's an archive which has its own activist contradictions, because it was in a social squatted center, the social squatted center got evicted, so for a time they were inside a building which was windows. I'm glad you know it, because it's really very, and I'm surprised because it's really not told at all. It's a very grassroots, very small committee. Right now there's two people involved. But I don't feel bad, really. I don't think, they're not aestheticized in the sense they're not owned by the Reina Sofia, they're not going to be part of the market, they're just going to be part of a story, and they're more on a contextual dimension than on a artistic dimension. What I think is contradictory in general is this kind of, in general, and I'm part of it, we're all part of it, the artistic medium talking about radical politics all the time, when it's sitting upon structures of incredibly unequal labor, unequal salary, precarious conditions, big money. I think that's the problem. It's not the problem that you talk about banners in a visual manner. I don't think it's worse that they're in the Reina Sofia.
It doesn't matter from that point of view. My problem is that modes of self-consciousness of political action and their relation to their activity.
I really understand your point, and I do think that there's a problem if you think that you are creating something really effective when you're just creating a powerful image. It doesn't correlate, and especially it doesn't correlate with the appearance in the media. That something appears in the media doesn't mean that it's doing anything at all. But I don't think that images are more guilty than words. That's just... I mean, if you have a newspaper article about whatever thing, and it's text, it's not doing anything more politically than the image. It's just that, as you said, social change is much more complex and much more long term than one image, one text, one action. It's also trivializing the critique to think that it's not effective because it's not effective on a, you know, an immediate level. And also, political effects are always much more contradictory. You can even have the opposite effect of what was intended.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask. Thanks so much. That's really great that we have this kind of discussion. By the way, what Julia is referring to is actually very much about your fourth point as well. But my question, let me just finish my question, okay? So it can be formulated in various ways, but I would just use this example since on the one hand, you mentioned Brexit and also like trying to take an analytical look at it with psychoanalytical terms, which I also very much share. But at the same time, I'm like also a bit puzzled with your idea of the crisis. So I mean, I thought I'm also in line of your like arguments. But at the same time, I'm really puzzled in a way that it sounded a bit like mysterious that since we cannot have a permanent crisis, so what we have as a permanent condition is perhaps something worse. So I'm maybe in this direction my question goes, and I will use just an example to ask this question. I read this just a couple of weeks ago, and it's really a striking story. I mean, maybe lots of people know this this background and this story. That he used to be really pretty famous. That's basically the situation with the mayor of one very small Italian city. I think the city is called, the town is called Riace, and his name is Domenico Lugano. Yeah. So just several weeks ago, he was sentenced to 13 years. But the background of this, it was actually that in 2016, but also before, he had been practicing a unique model of integration of migrants and whoever who was coming to the city, to the town, and he was like proposing and giving empty houses to live, working places, so they were settled there permanently. So, as I'm not mistaken, in 2016, according to the Fortune magazine, he was like praised as one of the, he was like on high rank on the list of the 50 most important figures and social entrepreneurs in the world. And exactly for the same reasons, he was celebrated 5 years ago, just 5 years. Today, for the same exactly reason, he is put in jail. So, and my question is, I mean, seriously, I mean this. What is this? what we have here, I mean, also referring to the crisis that we have, right? I mean, what kind of drive is here with the Brexit and this stuff? I mean, you can embrace it in different terms. But what's your take on this situation? Like, what we are dealing here with? What kind of emotion or drive? What is behind this intention of doing these things? So how would you conceptualize this? Is it possible somehow to grasp it, to capture this? Like, what is the core of this, like, be it far right or whatever initiative, but what is the core of this intention? How would you describe this?
This is a question about xenophobia and migration.
No, it's not about, it's more broadly, of course, but yeah, you can, just one of the examples, as I said.
I can't explain the particular case. Okay? I don't feel obliged to do that, but I suppose my first response, my response is, why are you surprised? You know, I mean, the My point about crisis is that it's permanence, is that that means if it becomes permanent, then it becomes a form of the social itself. It becomes a form of reproduction of the social. In other words, it becomes, you know, I don't really like the discourse of precarity, but it becomes a kind of generalized precarity, although that's actually not a great way of explaining it, but it's something like that. At any point, you can be subject to that kind of precarity at any point because of the surprises. So that the contradictions become more intense and more, if you like, unstable and unpredictable. And they give rise to, you know, the repetition of old solutions to different problems. Right? I mean, essentially, that's what's happening, old solutions to different problems. I mean, there's a fundamental contradiction between the behavior of individual states like the UK and, or indeed, the European Union, and the needs of global capital. I mean, they are hanging on to the fictitious nationality of their capital, right? Because, you know, the two big regimes of global regimes of accumulation since World War II, the first one was fueled by migration. The migration was contained by decolonization. So the roots of migration were stable. So that the ex-colonial powers could simply convert the colonized into migrant labor, whether, you know, by bringing them to the metropolis or not. Okay? But there was, if you like, a function, there was a political mediation of the need for migrant labor. The second resolution to some of these contradictions has been via finance capital. And it's clear that finance capital is not a sustainable resolution to the problem of the lack of productive investment opportunities, right? So it's not, it doesn't have a solution, if you like, built into its own logic, which is why there's this change in the structure of crisis. But the political forms are still replaying the past because it's all they have, right? You know, and the political form was always controlled migration, kind of enough racism to keep the domestic population happy, yeah? But not too much that you lose your migrant labour, etc. But fundamental, you know, developmental tendencies of capitalism require massive mobility of labour. The new technologies of communication, right? You can't contain these levels of mobility. I mean, it's, you know, European states, they're just filling holes in a dam that's about to burst, right? I mean, the whole thing has to be rethought. So it's a sort of, you know, there are these knee-jerk political responses because that's all that's in the political repertoire. Because that political repertoire is the political repertoire which sustained the viability of the state as a mode of social, you know, as a form of social reproduction. But maybe some individual states are no longer going to be the basic political forms of social reproduction. You know, maybe states will just become cultural heritage.
Yeah, I would suggest that we have to leave it at this point because we actually have the artwork within the exhibition exactly about that. Yeah. So thank you so much again, Peter Osborne.